So it's going to be easy. But please go ahead and do that, sir.
My name is Carl Gilmer.
Welcome. We're glad to have you here, Carl.
Okay. Actually, first item, under old business, it was 1888 house, which was originally known as the Water House. It's now a hotel owned by Sonny Arizona. He's requested a color of a retaining wall to be bay water and bare, 5380-4. We have some samples.
Is anybody here from?
It's not something that they exactly have to be here for.
I need to be reminded about the circumstances of what, where the wall was, because I don't remember it. I don't think I was at the meeting. I don't think Jimmy was. Carl was on the commission then, and I don't think Steve was. So we could be reminded of that.
My understanding is we don't have any jurisdiction of colors and deals.
Oh,
there's no.
The only thing we have jurisdiction over is if it hasn't been painted before.
If I can get you guys to speak into your microphone.
The only thing we would have jurisdiction over is whether or not, if this is an unpainted area,
it is unpainted.
Then we can make a decision about whether it should be painted or not. I guess the question is, color is not a relevant thing for us.
The question was that they wanted, you guys wanted to see a color choice come back to you for approval in the minutes.
This was originally going to be like just a block wall that they were going to put in, and we wanted a finished wall. So which one of these is
it? My recollection is that we recommended that they go back and find different materials for the wall, not that we were talking about paint colors, but if we can find it in the minutes, that would be great to help us with that.
I'm more than happy to do that and provide those minutes to you guys at the first
Tom.
Email.
Okay, that'd be great.
They were going to have both of them. Sorry. They were going to have both of them. I hear a motion. We approve or disapprove.
Did you guys want to table
this?
I'd
like to
table
this table at this time until we get more information about our original discussion.
Sorry.
Since I'm not very familiar with you guys and names and everything, if I can get you to say your name when you make a motion, and then whether you did, I know, but I'm listening to the recording when I'm doing the minutes. So if I can get you guys to say your names when you're making a motion, and then when you second it, and then can go from there.
Okay. Item number one under new business. Tumlin versus COA Cases, certificate of appropriateness to demolish existing building.
So, point of order, we're going into the hearing now. We're going into the hearing.
New business, yes.
Okay.
If you're done with old business, you're moving on to new business.
Mr. Tumlin,
thank you.
Mr. Tumlin.
I see Mr. Liddell here, my neighbor, Mr. Warner. If he's feeling about an hour, I'd give him a balance. To Mr. Warner. If he's not built by an hour, I'd carry on with item number one.
Oh, Mr. Tumlin, you will not do not stay at the podium where we can hear you.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
microphone's not working, you just want to step close to the podium and tell us what you want to do, that would be my option.
Okay. I think it's working now, but I'll step a little bit closer if you can't hear me. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, thank you very much. And I appreciate you hearing from me this evening. Good evening to you all. My wife and I were blessed enough to purchase what is formerly Davis Estate here in Dahlonega, located at 83 Choice Avenue this past summer. That is a 1 acre block of land downtown encompassing Choice Avenue, Grove Street, Meadows, and Maple Streets. On the south corner of Maple and Grove Streets, there exists an old barn that is falling in that has recently, at the attention of my neighbors, has attracted homeless individuals. And I don't know what more else to say other than it's a barn in bad repair, that it appears to have no historic significance, certainly no scenic significance, no architectural significance whatsoever. It's not an important building. The important building on the property is the old house, which we have sank a lot of money and soul and sweat and all that into. We're proud of it. The barn, however, just doesn't, we don't see a path for the barn going forward. It would be arch upon us to require it to stay there. That's about all I have to say. Be happy to answer any questions.
Does anyone have any questions, Mr. Tom?
Do you want to speak first, or do you want us to speak first?
I don't have a copy of the application. Did you refer to the drive or something here to replace it or anything from something?
I'm sorry, let me walk closer so I can hear you. Some of the wood was removed.
exterior while you're looking there?
Some of the wood was removed from the exterior. Did not change whatsoever the disrepair of the barn.
But you did take wood off the outside?
I did not take wood off the
outside. Okay. But you allowed someone to?
I didn't allow someone to either.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you said David West.
He took some off. I told him to stop until we had the hearing.
Okay.
I told him that I would allow him to start cleaning out.
So he didn't take it off with your permission?
That's true, but I don't believe it would be a criminal act of any type. What it is a misunderstanding.
I don't think this is a court of law.
I don't think it is either. I'm just stating my position.
Okay.
I had told Mr. West, who inquired to me about the barn, I told him that there's a lot of junk inside of it. And if you've been able to look inside, it is full of junk. Tons of junk. And I told him he could have some of the wood off of the building if he would clean out the inside of it for me. I think Mr. West found it easier to get stuff from out of the barn by taking some of the slats off the barn so he could have easier access inside and out of it. When I drove by the property today and saw, the barn already looked bad. When I saw how much worse it looked without the barn, I just asked him to stop until we could have this hearing to determine whether the barn could be demolished. So we're in a holding pattern right now. He informs me that he still has the slats and can put them back up if necessary.
Now, although that may not appear on any inventory of this sort of property, but I feel like it does have a historic value. I feel like that barn's over 100 years old. It was probably built when that house was built in the 1880s. We had made some accolades. It was one of the Blue Ridge Rifle members during the Civil War. He was also an assistant postmaster. And the post office was located in the front room of that one of the house at one time. That's just my opinion. The other members may disagree with me. It's a shame it's been allowed to get in the condition it's in.
For what it's worth, we bought it in the condition that it's in.
Well, I know. I used to live across the street. I watched it deteriorate for about 15 years. No one did anything with it.
If it wouldn't, I have assessed the cost. But again, it's, I think you mentioned the barn has gotten so far out of control that it would be hard for us to restore.
It is a shame. It's a shame because I don't know another building like it in town. It's probably one of the few barns left from that town here. But I won't argue with you about whether or not it's feasible to restore it, and it's probably not.
Your drawing leaves me a little confused after I look at the topography of it. I'm not sure how to put a driveway in without doing a lot of grading.
So there would have to be some grading done for the driveway in.
Okay, so you'd have to do a substantial amount of earthwork to.
I don't think it would have to be a substantial amount. I think that the driveway over the portion that replaces the barn would just take removing some dead trees. If you had the opportunity to look at the property and walk.
Well, it did. It actually looks steeper to me on the person that does the picture.
Steeper, did you say? So just
it's fairly dramatic slope there.
Well, there is one driveway that's already on the property farther up the street than where I aim to put in the new driveway. So just as well as that driveway exists, could another one over the place where the barn currently is. I don't believe there's going to be a whole lot of earthwork or a whole lot of grading to put in the driveway. And in my second part of my application for a land disturbance permit, which is not, as I understand it, within your concern, but I have asked for the opportunity to bring in some field work to terrace the southwest corner of the property to help with erosion.
Yeah, land disturbance is part of our.
Okay, well, excellent then. So, if you're, in my diagram, I didn't see a need to have a professional diagram drawn. My request was simple. The barn is in disrepair. It had homeless persons living in it. It's not salvageable.
Tom, unless you have anything else to add, I don't want to ask for any comments from the audience or against this proposal.
Nothing else to add. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Gibson, I believe.
Yeah, I'd like to speak out in favor of the barn, you know.
Frank, you want the microphone?
This barn is way over 50 years old. It's probably over 100 years old. This is a real piece of historic Dahlonega. You know, back in those days, every place had a barn in back of it. You know, I showed you what the barn looked like 5 years ago. It is not in a terrible condition. If you go out there and look at the frame of the building, you can't shake the building. It is an extremely strong structure. So that's incorrect analysis of this. You need to look into this further, because we're taking the position that no stick building over 50 years old can be torn down. You can't tear this building down. You know, it could be moved somewhere else. That's certainly possible. But you need to look into this closely. Yes, it is full of junk. You would expect an old building like that to be full of junk. But so you take the junk out. You know, if you look at the filing that Mr. Tumlin did there, I believe he admits that he personally took some of those boards off the building. Now, you see here back in 2015, there were no boards taken off of that building. If a person, if a homeless person is living in there, they're not going to tear the building down to get into it, or they're not going to dilapidate the building. The frame of the building is extremely strong. You cannot shake it. The building is not in danger of falling down. Not at all. So go over and look at it. It's a 5-minute drive from here. If you're going to take the position with Roberta that she can't tear down the park store, then this building cannot be torn down.
Thank you, Mr. Gillespie. I personally have knowledge of that barn for the last 56 years, and it was old 56 years ago.
It's a precious old structure.
Just one quick comment. The back part of the barn is already collapsed.
I'm sorry, would you?
Sorry.
Tell us who you are. Although, I'm assuming you're Ms.
Tumlin. Yes, I'm Lauren Tumlin. And just, I know that he's saying you might cannot shake the barn, that it's not coming down, but the back has already collapsed in. The roof is basically of the back part of the barn, like laying level with the ground, almost. So, just wanted to add that comment.
I believe it has a lean-to on it. It has a lean-to on it that she's talking about.
Are you going to submit a landscape plan? I mean, I'm assuming that a landscaping plan is required. I notice there's a lot of gravel already put down in the driveway, and normally that's submitted before that's done to the HPC for approval.
There was gravel in the driveway when we bought the place. We added gravel on top of it because the gravel was sparse and
it grass was beginning. Yeah.
It was grass was beginning to grow to it. We added to what was already there.
I mean, I'd say this is someone who does have a gravel driveway.
Yes.
But is the landscape plan going to be submitted for?
If he's wanting, if you guys grant approval to do the new curb cut, then he. As stated in my staff report,
right,
that what we would prefer to see is the pavers at the front, and then as it fades back over the hill, that it can turn into gravel. If he's going to be putting out more landscaping, then you'll need to submit that. But that wasn't in the application.
And I would say that we have been made aware of that you can that we would need to put in some pavers. On the front, we don't need. If the barn is allowed to come down, then we don't believe we need a curb cut because they're going to be cut. Other than the sidewalk, we won't have to be cut into the curb. So we would just be aiming to access the property.
What about the materials for the terracing?
The materials are going to be filled or to drop it with 2-foot terraces to the bottom of the property.
What's going to retain the terrace?
I would imagine railroad ties or.
So that would be.
Right, railroad ties. And we would aim to.
Okay.
Once that's granted.
I'll check on
that. Yeah, so we would use railroad ties or cinder blocks to bring that in. We would hydro seed the terraces to help erosion control the cinder blocks. And if we did put in professional landscaping, then I would submit you a plan on what I aim to put on the corner of the property.
Is anyone? Sorry, go ahead.
we're on the side of the building, of the barn, basically. And the fact that it was allowed to be, I realize it's not your doing, it was allowed to get into disrepair, but that, when you bought it that way, you assumed that liability was the case. In other words, that work, to our way of thinking, should have been maintained. It was an old structure, and I'm not shame on us or the city or whoever for not telling somebody to keep it up, but it should have been maintained. So I don't think the fact that the owner didn't maintain it can be used as an excuse for tearing it down.
When you say that we speak, are you speaking for everybody?
No, I speak for the way that, from what I know, the way I've understood, the Port Historic Board's operate. So that part I don't really know that I consider the fact that it's in bad shape as much as that's something the owner let happen. It should have let happen.
May I ask if the
so the question is whether the building is historic and is worth saving, and that's what we've got up into.
Does anyone else in the audience want to speak to this issue? Mr. Smith?
Yes.
I'm Ben Smith. I'm a history major at UD. The first thing I thought when I saw the picture of this building on Google Street View was I was trying to find the architectural value of the building. So from personal experience, I'm from Mount Airy. I grew up near Demers, and I know that the neighborhood around Demers is quite similar to Mechanicsville. It has a lot of buildings that are at least 100 years old, middle-class, suburban atmosphere. It seems that this building may have had a purpose as a livery stable or perhaps a carriage barn before the use of motor vehicles. So that right there, you're looking at anachronistic features of the building. It doesn't have a door that would open on a track or anything. It doesn't have glass windows from what I can see. It looks like a plain and simple carriage barn from that time period. And so you'd have to look and see how many examples in Dahlonega there are of carriage barns to see if there is value to this building and if it should be saved. And also, concerning tearing off the boards to gain better access into the building, I wonder if there's a lock on it that you don't have a key to, and if, like, why not just, like, cut the lock? Can you open the door? Have you gone in?
There is a lock on it. There's a key. If you try to open it, the door will fall off, and you have to prop it up, and it was propped up with some kind of brick or something like that. So it is.
So I guess it doesn't really matter if the door falls off the hinges just to get into it, because people are going to need to get into it sooner or later to see the...
Yeah, I should have asked you to speak to the board rather than Mr. Tom.
Yes, I'm sorry. All right, that's pretty much all I have to say, like, about access. That's my wrap up.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? And always. Does any commission members have any comments or questions?
I read that the black pavement, Zach, is there going to be asphalt used anywhere? If the park is demolished, there won't be any asphalt used?
I have no intention of using black asphalt.
Okay.
It will either be gravel or it will be pavers, or even if I decide to put in concrete, it would be concrete. Gray concrete.
Okay.
Anyone else? Carl, you can get your feet wet.
guys to speak into your microphone so everybody can hear the conversation. Thank you.
Are you making a motion?
No, I think we should have a discussion on these points and make a motion following our discussion.
Okay.
Identify what the answers to these questions are.
Do we not have a motion on the floor to have a discussion?
We're in deliberation. We're in deliberation of that.
All right.
Okay.
I'm on.
You want me to guide us through this little exercise? Do we agree that this is a contributing property in the district or not? Yes or no?
Well, if we agree or not agree, that's a vote.
No.
As far as I'm concerned. I feel like
we're discussing this. I would say it is a contributing property within the district. The property, the house itself, is old enough and it's in a significant enough place in the district that the property itself would contribute. Even if it's not in the inventories that we have, it would be a contributing property. That the main house would be. And the question is whether the barn is or not. If it's in fact, you know, a 100-plus-year-old carriage barn, then it probably would be considered contributing food in the inventory. Alright, if we agree that it's a contributing property, then the question is whether or not if we demolish this building, allow it to be demolished, is it going to have a substantial adverse effect on the architectural significance and value of the property itself? Now, the main value to me, when I look at the property up there, the significant structure on there is the main house. So if that barn were there, if the barn were not there, would the value of the house be diminished, or the overall property be diminished in any way?
I'm suggesting we don't.
I think it's because of its location on the property, you can't really see it from any vantage point on the property. It's down in the far left corner. it has a much lower elevation than the main house structure does. So it's difficult to see back there. Plus the vegetation has grown up and will continue to be grown up back in there to the point where it's pretty much obscured from the main house. So, you know, I would say it probably would not diminish the overall value of the property. Historical significance could be diminished.
But you rid of it. But then you say it into a motion.
I would put it into a motion at the end until we go through this discussion.
Keep going, Lee.
if we allow this barn to be demolished, it's going to have a significant adverse effect on the aesthetic, historical, or architectural significance of the district as a whole. The entire district.
We have a motion, but we have a second.
No.
So you're saying
that if there's a procedure,
the staff's finding was that it was not a contributing factor. Or we think it is?
That's why I'm asking. You're agreeing with that. Kevin's saying no.
But I don't know the age of the history of the building. We don't have we're kind of dealing. We're working blind here without, on some of these things, Bill has given us some background and small pictures and different things. And we've got no background on this one at all, so I don't know any idea of the age of it or anything.
The thing that struck me about this building again is its location. It's, if I look at the historic district as a whole, this thing is really on an edge. Mm-hmm. see it. No one really knows it's there. It's not on the tourist location. I mean, I don't know how it, if you were asking people what the value, significance of historically, of the historic history, you know, anybody's at that barn and that. Because you don't see it. Now, whether it's just overlooked or not, I don't know. That's kind of what I'm trying to feel people out of. I think it probably has been overlooked. But at this point in time, I mean, if it were missing, if it were not there anymore, then the question is, would the overall...
Well, then you're saying it's not a contributing factor, if that's the case.
I'm sorry?
Then you would say it's not a contributing factor, if that's true, right?
That's true. Yes.
All right.
See, I would argue that it doesn't. If we allow this, it would not adversely impact the overall historic significance of the historic district as a whole. It just wouldn't, I don't think. If it was located in a different place, I might argue quite differently about that. But given where it is, I don't know that it has that much, it contributes that much.
I would tend to probably agree with you more if it was just left taken down, left undisturbed. I mean, if you take it down and do what he's talking about, move earth and the driveway and all that, it dramatically changes the look of that area.
Well, that case does be approved.
Yeah, well, that's kind of a thought. If we decide it's not a contributing building, but if it's 100 years old, well, I don't know, it's hard to say that's not.
If it's,
we don't know if there's some history there, I don't know.
I know. That's the thing I struggle with too, with this thing. We don't know enough about it. It needs to be in a different spot. It needs to be saved, soured, repaired, and placed somewhere where people can see it and appreciate it for what it is. I'm not sure that's going to happen. The location is at.
Do you have any resource that you could do in research to give us any more knowledge of this?
I looked through the historical survey information that we have on that they did of the downtown district. I think it was back in 2001, somewhere around there. This particular property did not come up in that survey. So I went back to Ann-Marie's books to see if I could find where it showed this particular house, and if it was on some of her maps and her books. I could not find anything in her books on it. So as to your point that Bill would bring you stuff, there was nothing for me to bring forward to you guys. Otherwise, it'd be
informative. I have photographs that show the old house as early as 1900, but they're taken from a distance, and they don't show whether the barn's there or not. It is a sort of hidden behind the house.
Larry, man, it's that question. What would actually have to be done to restore this to a condition where it would be considered contributing to the district because of its age? How much work?
Is that a question to me, Commissioner?
Yeah.
I don't know. I've never even endeavored to rebuild a barn that has become into such a bad repair. I've never had to rebuild a barn to recreate the historical significance of which there's no records. I've never had to do anything like that. What I would say by looking at the barn is that it would require an awful lot to bring that barn back up to any kind of functional use for me. I would like to point out, if I do have an opportunity to speak again, if the barn was of such historical value and significance, I would think that people in Dahlonega would be reporting it as it went into bad repair. as the north side fell down, as the west side fell down. I believe that it would have been marketing materials when the house was on the market for sale. That barn was not mentioned one time because it has no bearing on the house as it stands, as it was most recently used. Remember, this house was, before my wife and I bought it, used as a de facto frat house here in Dahlonega. And there were about 30 boys living in it. And when we bought it, we found evidence of college students sleeping in the attic. So we sort of rescued the property because we enjoyed and appreciated the house. But the barn had no bearing on us buying the house. It had no connection or significance with the home in the current state as it was on the market when we bought it. And quite frankly, it was just there. It was there and it was in bad repair. We knew that we would eventually have to do something about it. To be quite honest with you, it's become such an eyesore that my wife and I put in this application to take it down because I knew neighbors across the street had even approached us about the lookup and what to do with it. Because it's just in bad repair. It really is. It's in such bad repair, nothing was ever done about it, no report ever made of it, no concern ever brought about it, another nugget never did an article on it. I've heard many comments of people get up and say how old they feel the barn is, or what they believe the barn may have been used for, but I've had no fact given to you guys. The only fact is, I believe it was the chairman said for 56 years he's had knowledge of the barn. And I'm 35, so I can't attest to that either. What I do know is you simply can't keep every structure over 50 years old in existence in perpetuity just because of its age. I think what we're trying to do here is preserve properties in historic downtown Dahlonega, which is a lot of what our tourist revenue comes from. It's why people come to Dahlonega. They come to the square. They come to see things. I'm a block off the square, and my property is about 20 feet descending from that block on Choice Street down to Maple Street. The commissioner is correct. When you stand on Choice Street and the top of Grove Street, you don't even see the barn. When tourists are parking in the city's parking deck between the Methodist Church and my lot, you don't see the barn because of the elevation. You don't see the barn because you can't even drive on the back of, it's a one-way street behind it. And the only people that we ever see, and we stay up here a pretty good bit, the only people we ever see walking up and down the street appears to be folks working at Buffalo's.
The thing I was trying to direct to is in the guidelines, the question about undue hardship and whether it could be an economic return. I don't imagine if this barn was restored, that it would have been looking nicer, to be any financial return on doing that. I don't know what it could be used for that you run a business out of it or anything. So.
The young man said he believes it to be an old library barn. That may be true. I don't know. What I do know is I have no intentions to use it to house goats or chicken or cows. And I come from a family dairy farm in Dahlonega, Georgia, Cedar Town. It takes a lot more land and a lot more structure. I can't milk cows in there. I can't raise chickens. I'm a lawyer, for God's sakes. So that barn has zero economic impact on my life. I can't rent it for parties. I can't have people staying in there. Other than just looking at it, it has no value. I will point out, though, I don't believe I can afford to restore it to make it grand and make it something worth advertising and have the chamber come and put it on their marketing materials. I don't think I can afford that. I do think that the city has power to buy it from me. I've read the ordinance up and down. I think you retain power to buy historical properties if you think it's of such import to Dahlonega that, and I think we'd hear a reasonable offer if you just want to buy it from me, but I'll leave that at that.
Well, I would like to say that it's great that y'all are in the house and it looks great. It's been a very stressful situation having that house in for so long and misused. So I commend you on that. The house has been well tended and looks great.
Can I respond to what Mr. Tumlin just said? Well, he made a big long public comment. Now,
he's allowed to as the applicant. He's allowed.
Yeah, but can he just talk on forever? You know, That built every house back in that period.
I object to the public comment portion of this proceeding, yep, carrying along.
Everybody had a barn back then.
Well,
his,
I
having a making milk and cows, that's absurd, his comment about milk and cows in that barn.
Do we have a map that shows the historic district?
Where's the border?
Where the border is, yeah.
Do we have a map showing where the barn is?
No, where the border is in the CDD.
Our maps are old. We need
we do have a map showing where the B3 and the CDD is.
Close to the edge of the CDD,
yeah.
Again. Isn't it close to the edge of the...
It is.
It's right on the edge.
Yeah. Is the house and the barn both the same district?
Yeah, that's the
B3. Yeah, why does it matter? It's in the district. It is definitely in the district.
They turned theirs into a carpenter studio, and now they turned it into a garage, store lawnmowers.
Yeah, I don't agree with anything about can't afford to restore it. I don't think they'd take much to restore that building.
It wouldn't if you're a handyman. It just depends.
Yeah, it's such a small structure, it can't break the thing.
You might need to do double joists that would support the roof of the original. I'd like to just see if an architect can, or just a handyman can.
Can we have work if you go through this?
Yes.
I can. I need to select two more points to discuss. Considering what this village should be demolished.
Should I ask if we have a flyer in our meeting?
Yes.
We have two more points to discuss, or three more points, I think, to discuss as to whether or not this. Before we make the final, what's the difficulty of reproducing this particular facility? Is there something unique about this facility, this barn, that the site, or anything about it that it couldn't be reproduced somewhere else?
Well, having looked at it, there's not much left to it. Much left of it. To have it reproduced, unless you could reclaim and recall all the. You couldn't restore it.
Well, the question isn't whether you should restore it. It's, the question is, we're trying to consider is whether you could reproduce it. You could take some of the existing pieces of wood from it and incorporate that into a reproduction of it. But is there something about this particular structure that is so unique that it couldn't be reproduced? Is it unique in the materials? Is it unique in the design? Is there something unique in its site location? That's what we're supposed to consider.
I say it appears not, just the step of the measures. It's a whole one. It's a very ornate, intricate structure.
You agree with that? The next point we need to discuss is whether this is the last one of the last remaining example of its kind in the neighborhood of the city. I think you'd all agree that it is.
I have one on my property.
Do you? Just like it?
I'm sorry?
Just like it?
Pretty close.
Okay. So it's
not... I'm not in the historic district, but I'm in the neighborhood.
I think there's another one besides that one? Yours? The two? So we're down to a precious few, I guess, is what we're saying here. That an example of this kind of structure.
This may be the last time we're here for a few moments.
Unless we expand the history. I better make some decisions quickly.
Then the next question we have to consider is whether there are definite plans for the property, if this demolition is approved, and what is the effect of those plans on the character of the surrounding area.
itself by the tenants, which would probably be an advantage, certainly an advantage to them. And my feeling is the landscape, the drawing that I looked at, as to what they want to do with this property, would be an improvement to me. What I've seen up there on that location now. That's my opinion. You've got to agree with that or disagree with that?
Zach, can you put the new driveway in? Would you stop using the gravel? Would that be changed up where the gravel?
No, I would probably still park on the gravel parking lot up top. The new driveway I want to put in would allow me to access the back of my property where there's another barn where I keep kayaks, settle kayaks, where I keep lawnmowers that I can haul. I need to put a little motorcycle in there. It would give me a way in and out off of the property. It allows me to park something that I want to park. For example, I have a utility trailer that I like to haul in. I've had a bass boat. I've had multiple things that I have kept on the mid back side of my property. And I can almost assure you that no one's ever noticed them. Because of the way that the property runs, you can't see what I have back there. But unfortunately, I've had to tow that trailer into the gravel lot, around the back of the house, down this hill, and then back it in. Otherwise, I use the muddy, ruddy driveway that is still there. So what I'm looking to do is be able to access the rear of my property to keep my personal things that I want to keep there that I use, and the golf course won't let me keep them.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
The next point we should discuss is whether a reasonable measure is to be taken to save this structure from collapse. When I went and looked at the barn, I've been there two times now, but before all the wood disappeared, and after all the wood disappeared, and I do see that it's where it has collapsed in several places. The question is whether that's it's gone to a point where it couldn't be saved. But again, we have to consider whether it's reasonable measures, and that's the only reasonable measures that we use to do that. You know, we have a lawyer in the room, two of them, we can debate more reasonable forever, but I guess the question is whether or not reasonable measures could be taken. In my opinion, probably so. I didn't see it. The structure in many places still appeared to be sound to me. There were some places that the structure seemed to be completely deteriorated and gone. And those pieces may be sound or replaceable. So I would probably say reasonable measures could be taken to save it. Do you agree with me or disagree with me on that?
I think it comes down to
what next question, is reasonable, is economic.
Okay. So what economic doesn't factor into reasonable. It's reasonably physically able to do it.
Yes, physically able to do it, not terribly.
Without rebuilding the entire thing.
Yes. That's what I think it means.
Okay.
My name's Mary Owens. So if we're not talking about economically, we're just talking about could it reasonably be renovated? Based on the little bit that I know, I would think, sure, I guess it could be.
Well, Larry, you're the construction guy.
Yeah.
What would you say?
I'd say we don't have enough information.
Still don't have enough information to be able to decide whether you could say or not.
I haven't been in the building, Carl Giller. I haven't been in the building, so I don't know much at all about it. But if the building's 100 years or so old, or older, possibly, the sizes of the lumber, the form, the structure of it, will unlikely be the same as what we use today. That may mean that we're going to restore it to its original condition. Newer lumber, whatever new lumber is going to be used, it's going to need to be hand cut or specially cut to form it. As we can't use today's 2x4s or 2x6s, the use today's materials to do that. So I guess I would tend to think it wouldn't be feasible. Again, I haven't seen it, so I don't know the size of those timbers and beam and so forth. So I may be wrong, but if they're that old, it's most likely barge lumber.
So you would argue that because we couldn't use it, we wouldn't want to use modern materials that were probably not reasonable to.
I would argue against using modern materials. We're going to.
It's a good point.
If we're going to keep it as an old building,
right?
I guess I'm thinking it's a barn or a shed, and I don't know if you're rebuilding a commercial structure or a residence or something. There's a lot more reasons to be concerned about it. It's, to me, this is a barn, so I'm not sure how much value it has.
I think that the key here is it's just the outside that has to be something like the original, because nobody's going to be going inside. We've always dealt with the outsides of the structures. So if the boards just need to be sanded and repainted, then I would say it's reasonable.
I think it's more than that, though. I think that some of the support beams and columns.
You can see into it from the road. I mean, you can see the disarray and collapse.
Yeah, but once you have the exterior cladding done, you're not going to see the support beams. Support beams could be replaced with something that's non-historic. Well, maybe you still have.
I go back to my point. We're talking about a lot of hips. You need somebody to look at it. It's probably roughing lumber. There's a lumber yard actually down there on 61. You know, cuts roughing lumber, but. Whether the bunks are structurally sound or not, I don't know. That's probably a big key. You know, so if that's the question, somebody, an engineer, or some sort of look at it, or a builder on the side, if it is feasible, it may be that. Doesn't matter what it takes to put on the outside of it, the inside of it's going to fall down anyway. So I don't know.
No, I'm just saying.
We're talking a lot of, we don't know these answers. We're talking a lot of questions, we don't know the answers to.
We do, but we're here, we have to make a decision tonight. So, like,
you know, don't have to.
We could put it off. And that's an option, right? I think if we can't make a finding of fact, then we could put it off and decide what to do. We have to come up with some options about what choices would be, I think, those.
You mean look at the economic piece of this too, because
that's the next question.
Next one. I mean, that may be the determining factor.
And the last consideration we're supposed to take is whether or not this building is capable of earning a reasonable economic return on its value that we're being restored. And we've heard from the applicant who says no. I spent a great deal of time thinking about this particular point, whether or not there was, you know, economic value, there's an economic return to be gained from this thing. And again, I come back to location. It's too far away from the square and it's like a tap for anybody to travel all the way up there to look at it. Okay? I mean, even if you charge $10 ahead, people to walk through it to earn some money from it, you're not going to get anybody to do that. It's just not in a location that you can do that sort of thing. I don't know if there are any utilities in that structure. It didn't look to me like there was no power, there was no water, there was nothing there. So a lot of that would have to be added. Because I thought it might be an interesting facility to have a coffee shop in or a tea room or something, okay, that, you know, you could use the ambiance of an old building like that to, you know, for a modern business application. But again, my opinion, it was just too far away from stuff. If it was near the park, if it was closer to the square, if it had a more visible presence within the historic district, I would think a lot differently about this question. Given where it is, My feeling was it didn't.
If I own that property, I would not go to the expense of trying to restore that building. But at the same time, I don't want to bring myself to tear it down either. I'd try to see if there's some an alternative, perhaps a historical society or some group would want it and move it. But I personally do not see other than having an old carriage house that no one else in town has, I cannot see any
carriage. You don't mind.
To,
if you don't mind, I'd like to comment on that. I don't want to bulldoze this thing and tear up all this old wood that people may like and love. In fact, I've just offered to give it away. How much charitable can you be? I offer to give it away to numerous people. And the only one of whom who was interested in it was Mr. West. And he came over there and he spent a great deal of time getting a lot of the junk out of it for me, because I told him that if I get permission to tear it down, you can have the wood off outside and repurpose it and build things and do whatever you want to do with it. And I'm just going to give it to you, right? Because if it means a lot to someone in an old Dahlonega family, or anybody for that matter, I'm going to give it away.
We're giving away one piece at a time.
Well, it's true.
It's going to be gone.
What I want you to understand is I'm not trying to bring a Caterpillar 963 out and run over it to say hi. I just personally don't have any economic opportunity in the building. I don't have any use for the building. I don't have any way to convert it to benefit me and my wife or our guests at the property or whatnot. It hasn't even, no one's even really noticed the barn or been concerned about the barn until it made it onto a public application for demolition, and then all of a sudden it has generated some interest. But, and I'll go to Mr. West and give him a time period to get it all out of there, or I'll hear a reasonable offer from the commission. If you guys want to buy it, go build something on one of your properties somewhere. I don't have photography on my property to reconstruct it on a different end or whatnot. If the barn is that historical and it means so much to some folks, I'm open to reasonable offers.
There are actually a number of measures that are cited in the guidelines in terms of what has to be done should demolition be approved. And that's on page 109 of the guidelines. And there is some documentation that needs to be taken place. And the reusable architectural materials and features need to be saved. Prior to demolition, it's probably two of the key ones. So you may want to look at that, because that puts a burden on you if this is approved in terms of what you must do.
My understanding is if approved, the commission would grant authorization with recommendation on how to do it. My understanding is that's how this works, is that you would issue a report, and in that report you would cite to the materials that you decide. So I'm unaware of that. My comment about the bulldozer was not literal, but I appreciate it.
This is a pretty property within the historic district. Demolition of this barn would have some historic significance, but it doesn't have any aesthetic or architectural significance within the district, within the property itself. that the proposed demolition would not adversely affect the overall value of the historic district. That the building does not have any particular importance to the ambiance of the overall district, primarily because its location does not give it any visibility within the district. so it doesn't really add to the ambiance of the entire district. No one really sees it. It's not impossible to reproduce or reproduce a particular building, because it's not, there's nothing particularly unique about it. There's no unique elements to it, it's not uniquely sited anyway. It is probably one of the last remaining examples, maybe one or two others within the city that we're not aware of, but you know, you're at least aware of one other in the city. There are definite plans for use of the property. The landscaping and parking plan has been proposed. If this demolition were to be allowed, it would allow use of the property by the tenants, better use of the overall property by the tenants. And it would have, I think, overall, it would be more appealing with this landscape plan that they propose. Can reasonable measures be taken to save this building? We disagree on that. Could be, depending on how the building were to be saved, collapse on its own. And I think that this building probably does not have any reasonable economic return for the say. Need a second.
Second. It's Mary Owens.
We have a motion and a second. That would be the motion.
No.
All those in favor say
that. The motion is to accept the
finding. Yes, motion is to accept the finding.
Okay. Okay.
Yes.
So we vote on the finding of fact.
We're voting on the finding of fact.
That's the first thing we
did. Yes.
All those that agree with this finding of fact, so without raising your hand.
Tumlin, there's a couple of things that bother me. This one is, and I understand the situation. Now, you're right, this board has been more reactive than proactive. We only have dealt with things when they've been brought to us, and we haven't gone out and dealt with things like we should have. I mean, that's the kind of things, at some point in time, somebody should have said something about their board. That barn didn't in the condition it was in, and you're totally right about that. I would like something like this to know what the plan is. If we approve the demolition of the material, there's some wood there that I think has some value, possibly not to us within our historic district, but it might come up in county or some other areas. And I'd like to at least see that you made some sort of effort to try to get another historic district or somebody to take that some of those materials and so that we'll know they're at least repurposed for historic use. And the other is I wasn't personally when I had with that landscaping plan, I was confused by it.
Well, why put another landscaping on it? It's just for the driveway
up. Yeah, and you mentioned like cinder block, we really don't. Not the kind of thing we probably want to see. So we would like to see a lot better idea of what's going to go back there. Because we really, that is part of what we do is we just take it down and we kind of know what's going to happen with it. So I think that probably is not an adequate. At least in my opinion, an adequate plan that you gave us, so what's going to replace it. Other than that, I understand the economics of it. And if you agree, it's probably not.
If
you have your business there, it's probably going to go too far to fix.
I think I understand a little more about that. I'm having a hard time hearing you. Are you telling me, are you saying that you would like to see it?
I'd like to see come to us at least and have shown an effort to utilize those materials rather than, as we said, just because as Jimmy said, if you just say, well, we give them away piece by piece, they're gone. The same as just bulldozing them because they'll never get used again in a historic.
agree. And
somebody who's going
to guard it. My bottom line is that should be done. And yes. I think that if we prove this, we should make it conditional that he follows exactly what's in our guidelines to document it and repurpose those, make those that the pieces that are available, not, as Jimmy said, give away plain white.
I think I have something that might please you. I would, on my most recent drawing that I submitted when they asked for an updated consolidated application, I would not mind putting at the bottom of the terraces on the southwest corner of the lot where the Methodist church, I would not mind putting up a small gazebo down there for me to put some Adirondack chairs there and hang out on my own property. Rather than using new construction materials, it may be that I could put some of the old wood and the tin from the roof on those materials if we wanted to talk about having some of those materials in use on the new structure put on the property. If the wood is even suitable, if the building inspector will improve it.
Yeah. I reckon like another can of worms.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Are you planning to put new structures on the property?
I submit that on my drawing, I would like to put a gazebo on the bottom corner of the property at the bottom of the terraces.
Okay, just the gazebo?
That's it, just a gazebo, yes.
Okay.
We would, but I'm not trying to build a hotel or anything like that. I would be willing to sell it if I don't want to pay for it. Somebody wanted to try to, but
I think the other thing, it seems to me we have a couple of options. We can deny this thing and say, no, you have to control this. The second thing we do, we can approve the condition that he's allowed to demolish it, but he has to preserve and make materials available for someone else. Third choice is, we take it upon ourselves, I suppose, to find a better home for that building. Or we, you know, maybe Mr. Gilbertson wants to buy it.
He
does.
He
can put it on there.
He wants it.
200,000. 200,000. Mr. Gilbertson.
No, I'm just saying that there are options. There are options.
Seriously.
I don't know that. Now, what we could do is we could have.
You called my name out, so I need to say something.
No, you don't speak. I'm sorry. That's not true.
Well, you know.
The other thing we could do is we could prove this. And with the condition that, you know, if you wait a certain period of time until we exhaust the options we can find to relocate the barn, find somebody else who would be interested in acquiring it, putting it on their property, that's supposed to do. That would become incumbent upon us and the city to make that happen, I think. I don't think that we could burden the applicant with that. He said he planned his trial, and I have no reason to doubt that that's true. I have no reason to doubt that no one was. I think we're interested in doing it, but that's a choice. If we feel strongly about saving this property, then we could save it.
Long along with it, create any hardship, undue hardship on you if it was approved additional on
time.
You give him plus 60 or 90 days to seek any group.
I would be happy to give the commission 90 days to come up with a plan about how to repurpose and remove the barn somewhere and come up with something to bring on Dahlonega. And if you wanted to put up the gold plaque on Dahlonega stories about how you did it and what you did, I'd be honored to be a part of that. My wife and I are in no rush to knock it down. We just know that we need to. And if we can do something else with it.
As a matter of consistency, the old business that we dealt with was a retaining wall. The yen was in the CPD that we had to approve. So if you want to terrace it and put some walls on, so, I mean, that needs to be submitted to us too. So
I'm afraid you're operating on, may I see what you're looking at? Because I'm afraid I submitted one plan, but what I was first asked to do is submit separate plans. Mm-hmm. One for the barn, one for the LDP, the land service permit. Then we were asked about a month ago maybe to consolidate our applications and update the applications, and I'm just wondering if you're looking at the most recent submission that I have given, because I did.
This is a drawing.
May I? This one is. I would be more than happy with an idea to hear from the commission about what you can do to save it. What I would like to say is I've already offered somebody in the community some of the wood from it. I ain't gonna hold that promise. However, I don't mind bringing him and telling him if you guys have a recommendation as to somehow or another restore it and put it on a structure, I can talk to him about that.
Okay. Again, we're trying to make a decision on ourselves about how we would want to condition the pool. I don't think we see any other choices as to what we could do.
I'd like to hear from Kevin what he thinks about the magnitude of what we're considering, because since the reality chair of the city, you know, I'd like to hear your reaction and thinking about it.
I think if you guys are willing to give him 90 days so that you can request from other parties if they would like to obtain the barn, and he is willing to give it free of charge, I don't see a problem with that.
I would just ask that I would just ask if we do that, if you would start with David West, the county building inspector, and ask him if he has a suitable plan.
Like I was saying, I don't see a problem with that. That's up to your purview. So, you saw my staff report. I mean, I can read it out for you if you want to. What my opinion was of it.
I'm trying to think of what the reality of trying to have moved in.
Well, there's been a lot of sentiment here to say on the commission. Okay, there is. So the question is whether we can actually call that to occur. And whether, you know, we can ask 9 days and make an attempt to see if we can find someone who will help do that, or we can say no.
If it was going to be moved, it had to be between two willing parties, not the city. We can't allocate funds to move the structure.
And we
I understand. I think we all understand that. Yeah. City isn't going to put any money into it. I understand that part. Very clear. Okay. But I think we have one willing party. Okay. And it would be incumbent on us or someone to help through the city to help find someone. That's what it would take. The question is whether we want to do that. Once we make that motion, or just make a motion that we approve the conditions that they follow what the process we have out in our contract.
We have a motion.
We don't have a motion yet. Someone needs to make that, one of those two motions, I think.
But who's willing to go ahead and actually start the search for a second party? Is the city going to take part of that? In that?
I think this is something the commission's taking on itself.
I'm always more than happy to help you guys do anything, but the city as a whole will not be able to. I can't commit the city as a whole to do that.
I mean, I think if the barn's going to be removed regardless of. It sounds like we're agreeing to the barn being removed. Whether it's being removed and restored or reproduced or renovated somewhere else, or we follow what Zach's plan is for David West to take it. We don't know what David's going to do with it. David lives in Lumpkin County, I think, and maybe he's going to sell it, move it off somewhere, but we're talking about both cases, the barn being removed, it sounds like to me. I have a barn on my property, like I said, but that barn really is falling in and is very dilapidated, and I can't imagine who we could try to get someone, but now we have to step back and see who's going to do that. Maybe Frank will find somebody to take it, maybe someone here will, but it sounds like we're making a commitment.
I don't believe that the barn's dilapidated. The frame of it is extremely solid. It's not dilapidated. Stop calling it that. The boards are falling off.
Don't tell me what to do.
So let's go over and look at it. Get an expert to make an assessment. You folks should get an expert to make an expert assessment.
It's quite possible. But there's no group or individual from the county that wish that will commit the funds and the time to restore this. be a good feeling to know that you're willing to give us 90 days to see if there's anybody out there that's willing to do something, so.
Who in the commission wants to step forward and take point on this? Because if nobody is, then that option's out the window.
Don't raise your hand at once.
I don't see any hands going up. We're looking for a second board if the commission wants to do that. Who on the commission wants to go ahead and spearhead that effort?
If the other people on the board on the commission will support it, I'll take point in trying to find some. I'm not going to go knocking on doors in the county to find someone. I think it takes a reasonable measure to see if someone is interested in the property in that building and see if they want to do it. We can add to the paper, we can do a variety of things through media to try to, you know, advertise the fact that that food structure is available. And if someone comes forward, other people on the commission know of people who might be interested in it, they can.
Can we compel someone to take that barn and put it back together and not sell wood?
No.
So in a way, we may be denying David West his access to the wood that he was promised. Or you said that you're going to give him a certain portion regardless.
Yeah, what I told him was, David, you can have some of the wood off the barn. You can start cleaning it out for me. And when the slats came off, I told him to stop because we have an application up here and we need to get some sort of formal approval. We need to do it for you guys. And then I know we had a hearing set up for a couple months ago. It was either December or January 1, but we had a hearing set up and the city attorney asked me if it could delay it. You know, I have been in no way wanting to delay the hearing, but I'm also in no rush to take down the barn. I just know that it needs to come down. And I hope I've demonstrated to you that I'm very reasonable in working with the commission on finding a new home for the wood, if somebody's willing to take on that project. But I would also like for it to be, if we find somebody, I would like for it to be done within a reasonable amount of time as well, because I'm not trying to have this barn continue to remain in the shape that it's remaining, the eyesore on the community that it is. And I have a different purpose.
You want to create a motion or something? No, I'm not. This is your motion. I move that we approve the certificate of appropriateness for the demolition of this barn, following conditions. That the applicant provide the commission 90 days to attempt to find another willing party to take the barn and have it reconstructed and relocated to their property. And failing that, when the barn is taken down, that the demolition be conducted in accordance with the procedure we have identified in our design.
Do you have a motion to have? Do you have a second?
Do we need to add the landscaping plan?
That's next.
Okay. You actually have two things in front of you: to approve the demolition of the barn, and then to approve the curb cut. Yeah.
But from my understanding, the barn is gone. We don't need a curb cut.
According to the site plan that was given to me, and I know it's hard to be able to show a road going in where the barn is located, but it shows that the road or the curb cut would be going in above where the barn is, and then heading out to the corner piece of property, the parcel that's to the southeast, southwest one.
So, when I originally had separate applications and I had a land disturbance permit to ask for terracing on the southwest corner of the property, the county engineer, the city engineer, and Mr. Martin came up and we looked at the property. and we decided to be able to get the filter in to build the terraces, then we would need to do a curb cut to bring dirt in. So that's why I applied for the curb cut. When I was asked to consolidate my applications and move forward, because quite frankly, I really didn't anticipate being in front of you so quickly on the barn. I figured it would take a while, considering all that's ongoing in the barn. I'm happy that I got it before you. But if the barn comes down, if that's approved, I won't need to cut the curb. Because where the barn currently sits, where the doors to the barn are, where the entire barn is, there isn't a curb. It's just sidewalk. I would be coming over sidewalk. So I would not need to cut the curb.
Then in that case, if he decides to put in landscaping, that will be a different application that he'll need to submit and bring before you.
And to be honest with you, I had planned on bringing a landscape application to put in some trees to block the view of the rear of the antique mall for my property as well, which is not a pretty sight. And I recognize that I would need to ask to put in certain types of trees to give me some more privacy on my road on my choice street, right? So that's the back of the Strange Road. The Strange Antique Mall borders the corner of my property on Choice and Netters. So when we're outside in the yard, it's not this beautiful view of Dahlonega. What I have is a brick wall in the back, so I would like to put in some landscaping.
Thank you, Mr. Tumlin. We did have a motion.
We have a motion on the floor. We need a second or
do we have a second?
Do we need to keep motion?
No, second.
We have a motion. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
Mary Owens, see, all of the discussion is that once it has been offered up and someone were to take it, Steve's willing to take this on behalf of the commission, do some basic investigation, promote it to the community. If someone does claim it, I didn't hear the motion say that individual would have a time period to then remove it. And I think in fairness to Mr. Tumlin, there needs to be, I think, 90 days.
Yeah, I did put 90 days in there.
Did you say that? I just wasn't sure.
I thought the service, what he said, was 90 days to give permission or whomever. It's a time to find somebody. If somebody took you up on it, then are you asking the Owens that we put in a 30-day time period for the next
Exactly. I'm saying for the individual who ends up taking it, that they have a time period they've got. Because if they say, I'll take it, and then 6 months goes by, and Mr. Tumlin's going, what are they coming for? I just think, I don't know if we can do an addendum to that motion.
We amend it to incorporate that, what phrase you like.
Yes.
Yeah, and I would ask you to consider 30 days. If I'm giving it to somebody, I'll ask for 30 days.
I think that's appropriate.
You must second that motion earlier. Are we okay with that amendment?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve a certificate of appropriateness. Giving the commissioner or whoever 90 days to find someone suitable that might have another plan. Part of the building, and if so, so you'll have 30 days to remove the building. Is that
correct? Yes, and failing the ability to find someone to locate it, then the building would be demolished in accordance with the procedures outlined in our zoning guidelines.
Right.
Sure.
120 days at the very most.
That's what we're hoping.
If somebody else. If nobody takes you up on the 90-day period, and it's all me, then I'll do it when I can.
That's fine.
All right. Everyone understand the motion? Yes. Yes. All those in favor of the motion, signify by raising your hand. It's unanimous. Thank you, Mr. Tom.
Now we have this application for
I'm going to accuse myself.
We're staying with the talking about the second half of this application.
On the land service permit to put in my terrace on the southwest corner.
That's the property.
We really only deal with the terrace. You know, we're not concerned with the terrace.
Land service.
I'm sorry. Say that again.
Thank you.
concerning the actual curb cut, your jurisdiction would be what kind of material would go in for that drive. So you have the option to approve it and then tell them what kind of material needs to go.
If he wants to tear it, if he wants to tear it, that's get into that. But if he wants to put a retaining wall, something like that.
If he needs to put in a retaining wall, then that's something. One, not only will we come back and look at the disturbance permit, that's something that should come in to play in the landscape plan that'll come before you.
Well, I'd like to make a motion that we, or do you want to continue part two? I was going to just suggest we make a motion. I'd like to make a motion that we follow the staff recommendation that the right way be used for seven neighbors instead of gravel or concrete.
The entire thing, even to the rear of the property?
Well, I'd say within sight. And then also there may be some issues about that, I guess, Tim would work, Tim Martin would work with whether it's appropriate for drainage and you know, whether we give way or not. Say, I would like to make a motion that we accept a staff recommendation that the driveway be built with brick or stone pavers within sight, within distance of sight, unless the city determines otherwise.
But it's gravel now.
Is that what you did?
It's not like that.
Well, I'm sorry, that motion.
Second. No, it's not from staff. Well, it's from staff.
Brick or pavers, does that mean to exclude concrete?
That would be my motion, that it exclude concrete. It's within sight, within the sight of from the road, street.
So you're, but you're excluding concrete?
For sight, yes.
For sight, okay. Mm-hmm.
The land disturbance part, we haven't discussed that part.
That has not come before you.
I know.
That is something that has been brought before you today that was not in the application. What was brought forward in the application was the curb cut.
Okay. But let me submit my land disturbance application at another time. I'm concerned with the barn right now.
Okay. That's it. That's probably a good decision.
And when the barn comes down, I'd like an opportunity, I believe I heard a motion in a second, to be able to put in a new driveway to the rear of the property. So I'd like some directions on what authority I have on that.
So let's take care of the barn and then we'll work that.
Because Alice has withdrawn her motion. Is there any further discussion?
Are you saying you're going to withdraw this plan tonight and come back to us with a landscaping plan?
Yes.
Because there are some, I have other questions about gazebo that we have. The other part that is gazebo. But I don't know what it's going to look like.
Yeah.
That is in our purview to at least.
And that's beyond landscaping, but that's an accessory.
It is now building, but
yeah.
But the landscaping is important. I'm also interested in the trees that are going to be taken down. We've had many debates on this commission about what trees should come down, what trees should remain. So I'm interested in that. We do have a tree ordinance in Dahlonega, and I'd like to know how you're in compliance with that. When you do your landscaping plan, I'd also like to understand what trees will remain of the existing trees you've been. Some of them, one or two of them, I don't know if you can't tell at this time of the year which ones are alive or dead. But If there's some older trees on that property, it would be nice to preserve them if possible. And so that should be, I think, should be incorporated in your landscaping plan to come back.
Yeah, so I appreciate that. I tend to agree with you. I'm satisfied with the direction I've been given on the barn. And as I said, I really expect you to have my land disturbance permit before you first when they were in separate applications because of the sensitivity of the barn. But here we are. I've been given direction on my barn. I'd like to give you guys 90 days to come up with something. And if not, then we'll see where we are in 90 days. And if the barn comes down, we'll take a look at what it looks like. It's hard to see what it's going to look like on the corner without the barn. and it may be wise to have somebody come in, maybe Mr. Buchanan from the city to come in and look at it, and we'll take a look at putting in a landscape plan, because I imagine that the driveway would be part of that.
The barn is approved.
The barn is approved.
Depending on what we do.
The barn is approved. When it comes down, then we'll have a blank.
Yeah, just what we do.
A blank slate. A blank slate, we can get the city engineer to look at, hey, the things that we can put in the driveway, if we can, let's look at a landscaping plan for the entire block.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Is that what you have?
So I will draw the rest of my application.
To some degree, you may need to get an engineer to look at that. That's not exactly Mark's job to come up there and look at private property, but I'm sure he'd be happy to look at it and give you a general assumption, but I'm not going to commit Mark to doing anything he's not comfortable doing.
I can appreciate that. I will have an engineer take a look at it. Mark will be able to take a look at the engineering recommendation as well, because that is his job. So, yes, thank you for clarifying that.
Thank you.
Well, I'll be very much. I'm going to recuse myself at this time. Mr. Steve Raxton, Doug Bell, the rest of the meeting. Thank y'all very much.
The next item of business is the application for the Squirrel. Mr. Wydell, are you?
I am happy to be
happy,
here.
Happy, happy, happy?
Yes.
I can believe that.
And I don't think I really need the microphone. I just want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to tell you about my fence. It is a new fence. It goes along the back of the property line to a disgusting chain link fence. It's been there since BB&T erected it, and the university kept it. What I've done is I have while I was building my deck, which was approved, and I think it's a very beautiful addition to the back of the building. I went ahead and I had put on a fence, which I thought was covered, and then realized after I was told by our building inspector, Tim, that you didn't need and didn't ask for permission. So I'm here retroactively asking for permission to have that new fence. In the front of the new fence are palm trees, which have been left untouched. There are a number of them. I had an arborist look at those. They are fine. And they are basically related to the big tree to the right of me, which is not on my property. That's a kind of way. The wood fence extends from the back of the property to the wrought iron fence to the right, where the big tree is. And it also wraps to the side where the back door cloister bar likes to keep its guarded. And so I felt like it was a better idea to have privacy and put it over there. So that's why I'm here, to ask for permission now, I guess, or forgiveness is probably the operative word, to allow that fence to stay.
Are there anyone in the audience who has, wants to speak for or against something? Okay.
This is my neighbor, Alan, and he's over. He has the pleasure of owning a number of historic properties.
I'm out of here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I didn't come to this meeting to speak for Steve, but since it's up, I will. I came as an observer from the Downtown Development Authority. However, I have spoken with Deb, who owns the Shenanigans restaurant in our house, and neither of us see a fence of that type being an impediment or any threat to our business, and we have no problems with it whatsoever.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, do you have any questions for Mr. Lydell on the fence?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say I think that I'd like to encourage the Historic Preservation Commission and the city to write a letter to the university to ask them to remove the chain link fence, because it is horrible.
It is.
It's a mess, and it's going to be pretty confusing. The questions I have, one, the recommendation of a shadow box design, I think is a really good one that Kevin made, or made it much neater, because right now, the way it is, you've got the finished side facing in and an unfinished side facing out. The fence is broken, it looks like to me. I have pictures of
it. No, there was a, it was prop, it was a door that had.
It looks like there's actually a
broom. But we can fix whatever is wrong with it.
It just looks kind of tenuous and like it's going to fall.
Well, remember what it faces. It faces a parking lot.
But those are visitors to our city that are getting out and
well, they're not. They're visitors to the university because the parking lot is not open to people. It's only
it is after hours. It's the people are allowed to use. But anyway, yeah. It would, regardless, I think the shadow box demands is a good suggestion, and I lean towards that very much. Also, the finish of it, the recommendation is that it be cedar, which I understand that, but I really just want to ask you questions for a minute about
sure.
You're standing in the parking lot, you look at your railings and your deck and support and the fence.
Right.
The nice thing about it is that they're both the same color, but are you going to finish them at any time? Or are you
no,
going to
it's, gonna, it's going to weather naturally.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I have two choices. I could leave it up or I could take it down. If I take it down, then what I have is what I had before, which is that beautiful wrought iron fence, which is not anything but an eyesore.
Chain link.
Well, forget it. It's a chain link fence.
Wire.
So the problem is that it's not wrought iron, which I can't take down.
Which is
not
wrought iron.
So those are my concerns. I mean, I would love to see it all painted for the color that goes well with the house, just to make it all kind of disappear, especially with the oyster bar having its trim in white and the light colored body of yours, but that's not us for us to choose those colors or anything like that, but I just want to make that suggestion. And I do think that the finish on the other side, and you're just talking about every other door, and then a fascia on the top to help finish it off and give it a much cleaner and better look, but a more substantial look.
Aaron?
I'm fine with
I'm sorry?
I'm fine with staff recommendations.
I have a couple of problems here. And I guess this is a 1910 house, basically, right? If this house were.
Yes, obviously.
The main house. Mm-hmm. If this property were in a residential historic district, there would be no way we would allow a modern 8-foot privacy fence to go up and around that property.
Right, and it wouldn't have a parking lot.
I know.
A modern building, which is a modern, let me just say this, a modern building that was built in the 60s.
I'm just saying that the design that you've chosen, it would be inappropriate in many other locations that you have. It could be envisioned. And I think that's probably the biggest objection that I have, is it looks and is basically a modern privacy fence on a historic property. I understand the problem with the chain link fence. I think we've had this discussion before, many years ago, about what should go back there, because I think there was a proposal to put a similar privacy fence on the oyster bar property.
Well, that wasn't for me.
I know that, but you were here. What we talked about at that time was putting in hedges back there, but vegetation along that fence to hide the chain link fence, you know, grow into it, grow over it, whatever, but it would be, you know, vegetation back there that would be natural, and it would be an appropriate treatment for that area. and of course that didn't happen, but I guess the question is whether that could happen. I mean, would you be
the problem that I have is the way that the land is.
Mm-hmm.
If you take a look at it, it is very rocky and hilly on that side where the fence was erected. It's very difficult to get in there and step. If you have to do land disturbance, then you have to go ahead and do all of that,
mm-hmm.
which makes it very prohibitive and also causes all sorts of problems with drainage and life. So that was one of the reasons we put the fence up. Now what we wanted to do is to put, you know, hedges and stuff in front of that,
right.
So it'll look very nice. But that I was not really concerning myself as much as maybe I should have about what it looks like from a 1960s building into the back, which has a dilapidated chain link fence along the back. I was trying to make it more private and nicer for the people who were in my building as well as have privacy and security from people just wandering through, which is another concern that I had, because people would go and cut through the back of it, which was a security risk and was a danger to other people, because people were coming in there, and I could not stop them from doing that. By having a fence, which also provides security, it's for safety and security of that area as well. Now, people don't jump over the back of the fence, over wrought iron fence, to go into some kind of garden. But they can, but they were using it as a cut through to go through the back, to go through the back to the oyster bar and to other places on the square, including Shenanigans and whatever. So by putting up the fence, we were able to secure the area, and there's no one who has foot traffic that comes in unless they're invited. And that's a different issue altogether.
Well, in addition to just the basic design of the fence, which is one issue I have with it, the other problem I have with it is it's large and it's very visible. Now, even though, first I've gone back and looked at it three times now, and I was hoping that far enough back on the property where I couldn't see it from the highway. And the problem is I can a number of places. You can see it from the garden, and you can see it from...
Well, the garden never stays, we don't know what's going to happen.
Well, I know, but that it's there now. I'm just trying to view what's there today, okay? And so you can't see it from there. And to some extent, to me, that diminishes, just the visibility of it diminishes the ambiance of community right now. If we can find a way to lessen this visibility, I could be very happy.
Well, what do you think?
Well,
put some vine on the back on the back.
Some what?
Some vine on the back.
The front. I'm concerned. The front.
No, I'm talking about the vine. In other words.
I'm
talking about towards the parking lot.
No, I don't. The parking lot issue to me isn't a problem. It's the street view.
Street. So basically, you're talking about putting some plant material in front of it.
Plant material would be good. The suggestion Alice made about painting it would be good.
I'll tell you what I think might work. I mean, I don't have a problem actually putting, and I'm planning to do what I can do over there. I don't want to hurt the pecan trees. Mm-hmm. So the pecan trees really obscure a lot. So you're talking about some other areas that would be close, like towards the oyster bar area.
Yes. Yeah.
I don't have a problem. I'm planning on putting some landscaping in there anyway, because I want to put some like Melfire on island ponds or things like that, so it really does have a nice shade in there. Mm-hmm. But that wasn't before us today. That's what I plan on doing. I'd be happy to give you a landscape plan of what I'd like to do. Right now we mulch, so it was just, it took away all the weeds and the stuff that was open. So it depends on what you do. I mean, I'll be reasonable, but I'm not going to be unreasonable. In other words, for me, economically, for me to do so much, it depends on what the cost is going to be and whether or not it makes sense for me to do it. Because honestly, if I just take it down, that's the end of it. And it would look like crap for time and work. And I don't really want to do that. I would like to work with you, like the shadow box idea in the back. I don't have a problem with that. That's a good idea. What I'm just saying, I'll work with you on making it pretty, but I have to make sure that I do it where it makes sense.
I think that's a reasonable position. I'm not advocating anything other than that perspective.
I'm just jealous. We're talking about in the back to put the board in the back. So
I had that in my conduit room, and just every other.
Yeah. I'll do that.
So I'd like to make a motion that we accept the recommendation of staff where the style of things has changed to a shadow box design. But
that's all the way around.
All the way around.
You're talking in the back. I can't get on somebody else's property. I can't go over to the oyster bar and do it there. That's not my
Is the fence over the property?
Well, the staff recommendation.
I can't get over there. I'm just saying, they don't care. They're not here to say there's a problem or anything else. But if it's going to take, I don't want to do all of it. I can do some of it.
But can you see the side of the oyster bar from the street?
I'll go up to the side where you can see it. I don't want to go all the way across where it's just garbage over there. I'll compromise on that. In other words, there's an area up there where the door, in other words, the side of the building ends and the fence continues where the garbage was left, and that's where that side is. What you're talking about is you don't want to see anything on the street so that you can see it. I don't have a problem with public view. In other words, I'll do the shadow up to the public view, but I don't think I need to do it more than that.
I see what you're saying. I've got a picture of it.
I didn't see that.
Here's a picture of the other picture.
You can't see it on the computer. I come up to this.
So you're talking about going shadow box from here.
Right.
Just draw all the way down the front.
Right.
And then all the way across.
I'll do that.
And then a landscape plan?
I'll give you the landscape plan as well, but I'm not going to be as
I have no problem with that. I just want to make sure we have a landscape plan.
When I get that done, I will make it. I'll show you. Do you have a bar on the bar?
Yeah. Well, we can. We have picked individual specific plants.
Right. You can tell me, I'm going to tell you all the plants in there that
would do that.
Yes. Here's what Mr. Hidell is willing to do.
I'll show you.
He's willing to start the shadow box. This point right here. Get all the way down here, get all the way down this way. He's willing to come back with a landscape plan and show how he's willing to landscape this area so the fence is not kind of obvious.
That's correct.
Okay. That makes sense?
We can't require Steve to paint it.
No. If you do, I'm taking it.
Take it down.
If I take it down, then
that's
fine.
We're going to put it around the bar.
I think what we want to do is, I think we would like to see it not be quite as bold as it is. Okay. Shadow box like this. Yes. Two, if you'll put in landscaping, it will break up the visual aspects of it. There, I find
this not going from here.
He's talking about going from right here at the corner of there.
That way.
Yeah, that we won't see.
This area right here will stay.
And it is the fascia top on this bill. I still got
the right stand.
Is it down the other side?
No, it doesn't sit in the center.
It's just on the other side.
It's just on the
other side. All right, let's do this.
Okay, there is no three side.
Yeah. All right.
Kevin, do you have any input on this?
Do you have a motion?
I would prefer to go with staff recommendation, but that's up to you guys.
Well,
I would like to see a motion on putting the shadow box in as he's agreed.
That's what I'm saying. I would like to make a motion to that we use staff recommendation to change the style of fence to a shadow box design to the point that was agreed upon by Mr. Lattell.
Right, to the corner of that. You can go ahead and put an X on that corner.
This would come in exhibit.
Yes.
Associated with your motion.
See exhibit A. And that the outside facing slats are constructed of cedar.
Well, I don't know about cedar. I think I have pine.
By appearance of historically accurate fence. And I think that's important to do. Including the landscaping plan that he's offered, and also that the gate should be altered to open to the inside.
That's right. I'll do it. I'll go ahead and do cedar on the outside. Doesn't
matter. And the gate will open to the inside.
I think it does.
As long as it does. I think, can it go either way? We want
to a lot of things are going either way. But I don't believe it swings inside the property now.
Okay.
I don't think
sure.
It swings outside.
If it was fixed, when I went and looked at it, it swung out into the parking area.
Oh, then we'll change it and go inside. It's no problem.
Okay.
I don't have it. Listen, I don't want it outside. I want it inside.
That's the okay.
We have a motion.
Why don't you make the motion since you got that on?
I did.
Yeah,
no, I didn't go any further. Kevin's got an idea.
Terry seconds the motion. Is there any further discussion on the motion? Does everybody understand? Now, this, we're making this contingent, this approval contingent on Mr. Liddell bringing back landscaping plan that we could look at.
I think it's, I think you have to let me start on this first. If you want me to wait.
I don't have a problem with you starting on it, I think, before you finish it.
Come on, you're talking about a shadow fence? Come on, guys, let me just finish it. I'll come back and I'll give you a landscaping plan. I mean, what do you think this is, romper room for me? I've been involved in, wait a second. I've been sitting here for 2 hours.
Okay.
Wait a second, sir. I've been here for 2 hours. I have two choices. I can go ahead and play and do what you want me to do, which I'm happy to do. I give you my word, and my word is good. I will bring you a landscaping plan. To me, I will do what I say I will do, and I do it.
Right.
Don't put conditions on me to go ahead and finish the fence, please.
Fair. That's fair enough. I agree. Anybody else have any objections to that?
I have objections in the tone in which it was delivered, but I don't have objections to the discussion.
So we have a motion and a second. All in favor, raise your hand. Motion approved.
Thank you. I will take care of it, and I will bring you a landscaping plan as I say I will. And I appreciate your hanging with me for a couple hours. Could we all be a break?
Our final applicant tonight is the Park Place Hotel.
That would be it.
And you are, I couldn't. Application.
Creston Warner. Creston. Warner, like Warner Brothers.
Would you like to discuss your proposal?
So the proposal is to erect a patio that's, well, the patio that we already have in the front of the hotel is kind of a space that has got a limited amount of use throughout the year. When it's cold, people don't use the outside. When it's, you know, drizzly, they don't get to use it outside. Our guests don't. So this would be more of a covered open air patio pavilion for them to use for meetings, make space for the guests to congregate and hang out other than their rooms. We don't have a meeting space, we don't have a conference room or even a large lobby. We just have the rooms and then our check-in area.
So it would be enclosed and heated and air and all that sort of thing. Just, you said open, and then the application has windows and stuff.
Yeah, there would be windows, but those, it's open air. Those windows will be, you know, open, closed. When it's not being used, you close it. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, I'd really like to see a design, a concept design.
So there should be a photo.
There is one being passed around.
That's not the actual thing, though. That's not what it's
about. About this.
That's the interior. We don't care about the interior. We only care about the exterior.
So the exterior is going to be
well, we need to see cedar.
They just said pictures.
Well, we needed to see a drawing because we need to see what the scale is with the other buildings.
Well, the patio that's already there is going to be the same size as that. So it's the same footprint of that patio that's already there.
My concern about that is, so when I went and looked at it today, and the entrance into the walkway, and where the gate is, to the right window, I call it Tuxedo House, and the proper name for it, the brick house, is to the right, and then to the left is where the patio is. I may be overthinking this, but I'm concerned about a structure being there causing the sense of a gap between the brick building and the patio and the welcome center. The idea of flow, and that when you're doing the patio towards the street, it increases its prominence. You know, it makes it feel bigger. But the way it is now, you've got the welcome center forward, and then you've got Park Hotel, which is big. So that I kind of feels continuous, then you've got the brick house, which is four, so it has a little more dominance. But when you put a smaller structure again, aligned with the brick house next to the Wilkins, you're concerned that it's going to be too prominent, it's going to be feel too big. One thing that would help it is if the patio wasn't as big as the floor was, because when you look to the right of the walkway, there's a like a landscape bed. It looks like it's about maybe, I don't know, 8 or 10 feet wide, you know what I'm talking about? The sidewalk's right there, and then there's like a landscaping bed, and then there's the brick house. Mm-hmm. If you could have that symmetry, that would help a lot to the left that you...
Well, that where the gate is where the guests enter from the office, where the tuxedo shop is, so they walk mm-hmm. around through that gate, into the rooms, into the private area.
But I'm thinking about the patio to the left, and the brick house to the right.
So
the patio fills that full floor up, it's going to take almost to the walkway. Is it not?
No, where the patio is, where the gate is,
mm-hmm.
so it's going to go...
That floor there.
So that, where the patio is, the square patio, you have the fire pit in the center, that floor plan is where it would be. So you still have that walkway.
What's the difference?
I know you have the walkway, but is there any room to the left of the patio? Right, so that's the question. Is there any room to the left of the patio? Right, so what I'm talking about is...
This appears to me as this is more yeah. conceptual.
So we know there's
a conceptual meaning, a conceptual application, and not a COA. Because we're talking about here your concept, and
yeah,
we need to see elevations and materials and that sort of thing.
I wasn't told about any of that. I wasn't told for drawings. I was told
well, you got an idea. You got an idea in the head, and we don't know what it is exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then I'll just go back to later day.
Well,
I mean, forget it. I didn't forget it. I mean, see you later.
We have a process for this.
Well, the process needs to be told. I mean,
where
was he not told?
It's. I told him everything that he had to bring, and it's also on the application. So.
Well, maybe what he can do if he doesn't submit those materials is not give him, put him on the agenda.
I'd love to do that, but once he submits
the application, that was our problem before. They should be completed applications, or they don't.
Yeah, they need to be completed before they're submitted.
That's right. An application is not accepted until it's completed.
Right.
We've gone, I've been through this discussion.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, and it...
Well, we're going to talk about this certain thing, Kevin.
Yes, there's a checklist, and the checklist has been gone through a number of times. I don't know what the checklist looks like today. I don't know if it's been altered since.
Yeah. This application was sitting on our desk before I.
You came, you rocked.
So, okay. I'm bringing you stuff that has been here, that as it came to me, I didn't prove it was accepted before
I got here. And I'm serious with it. We have a process to do a conceptual thing. He can tell us what his idea is, and we can tell him, that's good, just put it on paper so we see it. But
I'm in 100% agreement with you. I'm just saying that this was here before I got here, so it was accepted.
And we understood that happened a lot. We understood that. That was a lot of our frustration.
We've dealt with it.
I know.
I think what we probably need to do is we need to invite Mr. Warner to a meeting and go through the application checklist with him and make sure he understands exactly what he needs to submit, including elevations and drawings, and express some of the concerns. I had a number of concerns about it. Just like Alex did, the mass of that building. This idea concept here is, when you try to estimate the size of the interior, you could think it's way bigger, I think, than what he's got in that
room. He didn't even tell us what size of the patio
is. Yes. The height of this building is, and so I think we need to express a number of these concerns to him about the mass of the building. We also need to understand that the design should reflect some of the features of the...
And I'm lying to myself tonight.
I'm sorry, what's that?
I said, I'm lying to myself about what all these do.
Kevin, can you give me a whatever that...
I'll bring you everything and walk with me sometimes.
Well, I'll be out of town, but...
Shoot me an email and we'll get together.
Preston, come back and talk to us. We understand your
question,
we are too.
Yeah, this is, come on.
Yeah,
I mean,
look,
I wasn't told drawings, you would have had drawings.
I, so. and
In some instances, you submitted this kind of in a transition period, where the people that were running this thing all along, Kevin wasn't here, and somebody probably in the office in there just took it, not knowing what they should
do. And a lot of us weren't here.
And it's a lot of water on the bridge. We're willing to work with you. I'm trying to make sure that you understand what you need and what we need in order to evaluate.
Not what you want, and you'll get it.
Well, that's what we have a process where you can kind of tell us what you envision, and we'll tell you if that looks good, but then you'll.
Right.
Then you can put it on paper and bring it back to us, and it's a lot smoother, right, I guess. And we've done that before, rather than you put it on paper and then have to go back and change it, I guess is what it's.
I've done it a couple times, but okay. When I brought this up, this was not, drawings were not mentioned. When I renovated the tuxedo shop, which is now our office, I believe, Ms. Mary, I believe you were there, we had drawings, we had blueprints, we had an architect.
Yes.
So, you know, all of that was done. So, you know, this is just a covered patio that's on our property.
But it faces the square. You know, can imagine the kind of
sure.
Thing that's going to take into the impact it could happen on the square.
Sure.
That's a very important spot. Right?
Yeah.
I think
it's the only hotel in downtown square.
Yes.
And it'll probably only be the only hotel forever on downtown square.
So
I don't see any property that's not available.
We have to move judiciously and make sure that we don't do something we can't undo.
Tell me what you want.
My first thought from the conceptual picture that you had was a roof more similar to what you got on the hotel, but open inside rather than the tent. I mean, it appears to the drawing that you show of the picture you have of this. Has more open.
It's got the wood beams inside with skylights and more of a clearer roof for the greenery to grow. With the guests and being a two-story building and down in that hole of where it is, doing a pitch roof of 12-2 or something with shingles is going to stick out like a sore thumb, I think.
Yes.
I think a lighter pitch roof of a darker tint. With maybe some skylights or whatever in it, I think it would be a lot easier on the eyes and it won't be as obtrusive as a big high gable roof.
Do we have tin roofs in town?
We do have a shell.
There's one square that had a tin roof on them?
Yes.
This one appears to be skylights in between the beams, which would be a neat concept.
Would
way more expensive than a tin roof.
On the square, but it's on the eyes.
That's what I mean on the square.
Yeah, of course, there's a house, residential house down, going down towards the Colorado on West Main.
Is it Scanlon's then?
Yeah, but I'm just thinking about the flow on the square.
Rick's old place is changed.
Yeah,
yes.
But you're not building the 1800s, it's not 1800s building, so I'm just thinking about that.
Are you going to break it part of the way up like what that was?
So the pavers that we have on our patio already, which are the brick pavers, which match a lot of the stuff already around, we would use those as the knee wall. Wow.
Those brick pavers. And the columns are kind of new material. So
the pillars would be cedar pillars with the brick knee wall around.
So are you going to change your entrance to match that?
Our entrance for?
Where your wrought iron fences and the.
Well, those down that gate would say where it is.
But not going to change the material there, because it's going to start getting a big mishmash of materials.
Of the rye?
The pink stone, new material.
So those top of the big caps,
mm-hmm.
Those would go up.
Okay.
So the brick part, the 4x6 brick itself, mm-hmm. would be the one that would be the new wall around.
Okay.
Those rough.
Are you talking about around the patio, or are you talking about your entrance? I'm talking about in the entrance, there's a, it's got the lights on it. It's got lights, the gate.
So those are set. Those are set.
Yeah, it's starting to get a mix of.
So you have a knee wall like this and then a window similar to this? Is that what you're.
Well, the window is not going to be like that. It's going to be a black window, accordion style window.
So you're not really, it's not going to match the hotel at all?
It's not going to match those colors because it's all going to be repainted.
But is it going to match the colors that it's going to be repainted to?
Mm-hmm.
That's
be that.
Yeah.
So you think it won't match the style of the hotel bar? I mean, when I look at
the
hotel,
the brick, the hardy board, no. I don't want to go back to the hardy board because it doesn't give you
much. Think about the columns. The hotel has thin columns all the way down. It has picket railing for a fence.
You're going to have a little side of it anyway, it's going to be all solid, isn't it?
Yeah.
Windows and columns.
Where? On the fence?
Yeah.
I mean, there'd be posts and columns just like on the front of the hotel.
And windows in between, right? So you really don't have any side.
No, there wouldn't be any side on
it. Yeah. So.
Well, it sounds like you're thinking along the way we would be thinking about what we'd be looking for
at this.
And so I think what we'd like to do is have you come in and meet with Kevin and make sure we understand what the application needs to have in terms of drawings and stuff like that. So then I think we can do a fair job. And I think some of us would be willing to meet and evaluate it ahead of time to make sure that it's smooth sailing, if you will.
I would suggest that what you guys do is you table this one to next meeting, and we'll get together and we'll get a hold of some elevations for you guys to look at, a better description or samples of the material in which
we need to draw.
And then we'll get that to you.
And ideally, it would be photoshopped into the space now, so you can see the scale of it and the impact of it.
The scale is an important feature of this. I kept looking at the drawing, the picture, and I kept thinking, you're going to have a 20-foot building in front of a hotel, not a casino hotel.
Your hotel's going to really receive
just
that. So it wouldn't, where that patio is now, that sits up 3 feet,
mm-hmm.
that is where the base of the floor for this would be. So it would be an additional, 10 feet, 12 feet from there.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be any taller than the kiosk that's next door to the chamber.
Okay.
That cover?
Yeah.
Because it's down in that hole.
Actually, if you could mimic that some, it would be kind of a...
Yes.